This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. On today's show, the threat to the Congo Basin. I'll speak to Friends of the Congo Executive Director Maurice Carney and his colleague on the front lines, Samuel Yagase. Then we'll switch gears and speak to Sophia Murphy, Executive Director of Institute for Agriculture and Trade Policy, on the upcoming COP27. But first, the news.
I'm Christina Onnestead with KPFA News Headlines. Former President Donald Trump faces a congressional subpoena to testify on his role in the deadly January 6th Capitol attack. The House committee investigating the insurrection held its hearing Thursday. Christopher Martinez reports.
The committee recapped a now familiar narrative, the big lie and the fact that Trump was in a position to know he lost the election. His multi-pronged scheme to pressure election officials, the Justice Department, and the Vice President. And finally, armed groups like the Proud Boys and the Oath Keepers storming the nation's capital on January 6th, all with Donald Trump at the center. Committee Vice Chair Liz Cheney, a Republican from Wyoming.
But our nation cannot only punish the foot soldiers who stormed our capital.
Republican Adam Kinzinger of Illinois showed a video of White House aide Kathy Hutchinson's testimony where she describes Trump as being livid after the Supreme Court denied his final election lawsuit.
This typical anger outburst at this decision. And the president said something to the effect of, I don't want people to know we lost, Mark. This is embarrassing. Figure it out. We need to figure it out. I don't want people to know that we lost.
The committee does not have any more public hearings scheduled. It's expected to work on a final report and recommendations by the end of this year. Reporting for Pacifica Radio News KPFA, I'm Christopher Martinez.
Climate justice activists have blocked entrances to the annual meeting of the International Monetary Fund and World Bank this morning, demanding they cancel the debt of developing nations and stop funding fossil fuel developments. Activists say the World Bank has funded nearly $15 billion in fossil fuel projects since the global Paris Climate Accord to curb greenhouse emissions.
The committee.
The people and planet. Cancel the debt.
Activists have converged in Washington, D.C. to protest inaction on climate change and slam World Bank head David Malpass for denying climate change, a stance he's tried to roll back on. Police say a 15-year-old boy is the shooter who killed five people and wounded others along a walking trail in North Carolina's capital. After a man hunt for the teenager, he's now in the hospital in critical condition. Authorities say he eluded officers for hours before was cornered in a home and arrested. A 16-year-old boy and an off-duty police officer were among those killed. Here's Raleigh's Mayor Mary Ann Baldwin and North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper.
We have doubled our determination now to end senseless gun violence that has grips on our country and now on our city. I know that brings us all sadness and anger. We have to do something.
No neighborhood, no parent, no child, no grandparent. No one should feel this fear in their communities. No one. As policymakers, we cannot and we will not turn away from what has happened here. We must be resolved to make changes and to succeed.
Two people, including another police officer, were taken to hospitals. The officer was later released. The other survivor remains in critical condition. Authorities have not offered any details on the motive. A divided jury spared Florida school shooter Nicholas Cruz the death penalty for killing 17 people at a Parkland high school in 2018, sending him to prison for the rest of his life. In a decision that left many families of the victims angered, baffled, and in tears, one survivor of the shooting called the death penalty barbaric and said it would not bring back the dead. Britain's Prime Minister Liz Truss has abandoned a planned corporate tax cut, scrapping a key part of her economic plan that sparked weeks of market and political unrest. Truss said at a hastily arranged news conference today, She fired Kwasi Kwarteng as Treasury Secretary, replacing him with a former cabinet minister, moderate Jeremy Hunt. Truss is trying to restore order after 3 weeks of turmoil sparked by the government's tax-cutting mini-budget. She vowed to press on with other aspects of the economic plan. The conservative has. Ukraine's allies vowed to supply the besieged nation with advanced air defense systems as Russian forces attacked Kiev with kamikaze drones and fired missiles elsewhere at civilian targets. Missile strikes killed at least 5 people and destroyed an apartment building, while heavy artillery damaged more than 30 houses, a hospital, and a kindergarten in the town of Nikopol across the river from Russia's occupied Zaporizhia nuclear power plant. The head of NATO says the Western military alliance will conduct nuclear deterrence exercises next week that are routine and annual. Jens Stoltenberg made the statement yesterday, and he downplayed NATO's use of nuclear weapons while warning against Russia's use of them.
The fundamental purpose of NATO's nuclear deterrent is to preserve peace and deter aggression and prevent coercion against NATO allies. Circumstances in which NATO might have to use nuclear weapons are extremely remote. Russia's nuclear rhetoric is dangerous, reckless, and they know that if they use nuclear weapon against Ukraine, it will have severe consequences, and they also know that a nuclear war cannot be won and should never be fought.
The danger of nuclear war has increased with Russia's invasion in Ukraine. Russia's news agency TASS reports its Security Council Deputy Secretary Alexander Venediktovas warned the accession of Ukraine to NATO could lead to World War III. He called Ukraine's fast-track application to join the alliance a propaganda move, noting the escalation it would cause, saying, quote, NATO members themselves understand the suicidal nature of the move, unquote. European Union Foreign Policy Chief Joseph Borrell chimed in, warning Russia would be annihilated if it uses nuclear weapons in Ukraine. He was speaking at a diplomacy academy in Brussels. While he urged diplomacy, he also discussed the establishment of an EU military assistance mission to support Ukraine next week, an apparent ramped-up military response, one of the moves Russia says makes Western countries a direct party in the war. The Justice Department says Orange County's Sheriff Department and District Attorney's Office ran an extensive jailhouse informant program for years that violated the rights of criminal defendants. It issued a report yesterday about an investigation that finds from 2007 to 2016, not only did officials improperly use informants to violate inmates' constitutional rights, prosecutors failed to overturn critical evidence to defense attorneys as required. The weather forecast for the San Francisco Bay Area today, partly sunny on the coast, highs in the 60s, clearing with sun around the bay, highs in the low 70s, sunny further inland, highs 80 degrees in Fresno and the central San Joaquin Valley, sunny, highs in the upper 80s. I'm Christina Onnestad. News headlines returns at noon and 4, and please join us at 6 for the Pacifica Evening News tonight.
Good morning, good morning. Good morning to you, folks. This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. We are back. We're going to listen to this 6-minute video that explains the carbon bomb and the threat to the peatlands of the Congo Basin. And then afterwards, we're going to further the discussion with my guests, Maurice Carney and Samuel Yagase, on the need for global partnership with local communities in the Congo Basin. Now, if you didn't already know, the Congo Basin sequesters more carbon than the Amazon or any other rainforest on the planet, and is one of the most important places for biodiversity. So here's 6 minutes of intense education on the peatlands of the Congo Basin.
Hidden in the northern Congo Basin, home to the world's second largest rainforest, lies a mysterious swamp. In 2012, a team of scientists from Central Africa and the UK traveled to the Republic of Congo on a hunch. Led by plant ecologist Simon Lewis and PhD student Greta Dargy, the researchers suspected this little understood swamp, known as the Cuvette Centrale, could hold precious peat deposits. Essentially, peat is soil made up of partially decomposed organic material that accumulates over time, often thousands of years. It exists where bits of plants pile up and there's enough water to slow down the bacteria and fungi that would typically break down this organic matter. that peat found in the world's colder, temperate regions is more common and better known. But could the Cuvette Centrale hold peat? And if so, how much? Dargy, Lewis, and their colleagues knew peat also forms in tropical forests in the right circumstances. So on their initial trip to the Republic of Congo in 2012, they began looking for other clues that they were on the right track. Earlier studies suggested the swamp in this part of the Congo Basin might contain peat. Beyond that, though, reports had little hard data on its extent or depth or whether it existed there at all. Satellite data helped the scientists pinpoint potentially peaty areas. These places needed to have the right sorts of plants. Water sources were also critical, so they looked for spots where rivers spilled over their banks or depressions where rainwater pooled enough to flood the forests. With this rough map in hand, they set out to ground truth their hunch. Over the course of nearly 2 years and several trips, the team worked with communities in the area and trudged through the hip-deep mud of the peatlands. They traced lines or transects, and every 250 meters or about 800 feet, they would stop and take a core sample of the earth. Later on, they would do the same thing in the neighboring Democratic Republic of Congo. Their hunch turned out to be correct. Examinations of the core samples revealed the most extensive tropical peatland on Earth. The peat here covers more than 145,000 square kilometers, or 56,000 square miles. That's about the size of England, and it spans the border region between the two Congos. Tropical peatlands serve as natural refuges for all kinds of threatened and endangered animals, forest elephants, lowland gorillas, and bonobos, just to name a few. And local communities depend on the services they provide. Yet it's the carbon the peat holds that has catapulted them into the global climate conversation. Scientists figure this partially decomposed plant matter in the Congo Basin contains more than 30 billion metric tons of carbon. That's about the same amount the U.S. emits from the burning of fossil fuels in 20 years. The team also figures that the relatively small peatlands, which cover only about 4% of the Congo rainforest, hold as much carbon as the trees across the entire rainforest. This carbon is a precious resource. The peat locks it away out of the atmosphere where it can further warm the planet. Climate scientists say that makes protecting that area vitally important. In temperate regions, dried peat has been burned for heat and cooking for hundreds of years, and peat bogs and fens have been drained to make room for agriculture. That's true in the tropics as well. Today, seemingly endless rows of oil palm trees grow on former peatlands in Southeast Asia. They provide the vegetable oil demanded by the global economy and are credited with boosting the economies of countries like Indonesia. But those gains have come at a cost. The peatlands there had been a sink that kept the carbon from the atmosphere. Now, in many places, they're a persistent source of climate-warming gases. Fire, too, has become a growing problem. Farmers often burn their land to prepare it for cultivation. But when those fires spread and burn for weeks or months, they create regional and global problems. Fires in Indonesia in the particularly bad year of 2015 released millions of tons of carbon into the atmosphere every day at their peak, blanketing the region in haze. Researchers estimate that the smoke from these fires caused at least 100,000 human deaths across Southeast Asia. Central Africa's peatlands are the largest and most intact in all the world's tropics, but logging, agriculture, and oil and gas exploitation have been proposed across as much as 80% of the Congo Basin peatlands. In some places, work toward extracting those resources has already begun. At the same time, the world is struggling to cope with climbing temperatures and the impacts they have. To avoid the worst effects of climate change, experts say we shouldn't disturb natural repositories of carbon like the peatlands. Today, Indonesia is working to reforest and reflood former peatlands. These efforts may slow the release of carbon dioxide from the peat. Still, it would take decades or even centuries to recreate peat-anchored ecosystems in these places. Protecting peatlands before they're disrupted or destroyed will spare the atmosphere from vast amounts of carbon emissions. It will also benefit the communities and wildlife that live around them. In 2018, leaders from Indonesia signed the Brazzaville Declaration with the Republic of Congo and the Democratic Republic of Congo. The three countries have also worked with the UN Environment Program to create the Global Peatlands Initiative. Their goal is to share lessons and foster exchange between tropical peat-bearing nations around the world. Currently, scientists, including Dargy and Lewis, are working to better understand how the Congo Basin peatlands formed and what our changing climate might mean for them. They also want to learn how long-established communities have made sustainable use of this vital resource, perhaps providing an example for managing peatlands responsibly. In part, that's because the threats of industrial-scale resource extraction and agriculture remain. Still, advocates say that with the proper protections, the pristine peatlands of the Congo Basin and the carbon they hold could remain a valuable tool in combating climate change.
And here to further the discussion is a longtime friend of A Rude Awakening, the executive director of the Washington-based nonprofit Friends of the Congo, Mr. Maurice Carney, as well as his colleague who actually... his village is in the Congo Basin, Mr. Samuel Yagase, and he is a key player in mobilizing rural communities for local development and justice in the Congo Basin. And he's based in Tolau, in Sangi Territory, Oriental Province, in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Gentlemen, welcome to A Rude Awakening. This is an amazing conversation that I cannot wait to have. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you so much.
All right. So talk to us about what is going on. We just watched the, or listened to, not watched, but listened to the 6-minute just a very intense education on the peatlands of the Congo Basin. So talk to us about, Maurice, we'll go ahead and have you start the conversation here. And Samuel, Mr. Yagase, you can go ahead and chime in as you feel free and fit to. But talk to us about what's going on as far as these peatlands. This is just, it's a shame that these logging companies and these oil companies are able to exploit that land. Go ahead, Mr. Maurice Carney. Go ahead.
Sure. Thank you, Sabrina. Well, as you know, we've been on so many occasions, and your listening audience should have an understanding at this stage that the Democratic Republic of the Congo has served and continue to serve as an outpost for extraction. First, extraction of human beings during the period of enslavement, extraction of natural resources. And that has not stopped. That blueprint is still much, very much in place. And as you stated, with this recent advent of the Congolese government offering up oil blocks for sale, we have, I guess, the latest version of an assault on the Congo Basin in particular. And that is of concern to not only people like Samuel who live in the rainforest, but also people who are concerned about the climate crisis. And Samuel is one of the folks on the front lines who are organizing not only to challenge the government and its policies, but also to preserve and sustain the rainforest for the benefit of his village, the benefit of Congo, and for the benefit of the globe as a whole. And Samuel can share with you some of the things that the organizing efforts that they've done there, in not only Tolau, but in the Isangi region as well.
Wonderful. Mr. Samuel Yagase, now you're the founder of the NGO GOVA, Group of Village Organizations for Self-Development. And so talk to us about what you're doing on the ground there with the villages, communities that are being hit hard by this oil and logging exploitation.
Yeah, thank you. We are trying to do lots of things in terms of local initiatives in different areas. Let me focus on what we are trying to do in terms of preserving the forest of the Congo Basin with, at the grassroots level. And why am I insisting on the grassroots level? Just because there are lots of initiatives, you know, set up by some international NGOs, by the agency, you know, of the Congolese state. But most of those projects, you can see that people at the grassroots are put aside. They are not really involved, you know. They just, you know, for instance, for the big companies coming in, they say, okay, we have been to Kinshasa, we have bought everything, we have our papers. So they come to the village, they say, oh, you have to leave this place. You don't have the permission anymore to enter this forest because we need to, you know, to exploit that forest in terms of cutting timbers and so on. So it is causing lots of conflict between big companies and the local people, and conflict between government agencies and local people. For the Congolese people, as Maurice said, you know, they are used to be, you know, exploited by, you know, not international, but big companies in terms of taking minerals and taking timbers and so on. So we need to organize, we are trying to organize local people to see how they can resist that kind of, land grabbing activities of these big companies, how they can organize themselves to defend themselves. And we are trying to promote some kind of dialogue between state agencies, companies, big companies, and local people to preserve, local interests, the interests of the local people, which is not easy at all. But we need to do it. Otherwise, local people will be like, they are going to lose their land, and they are losing their land when for their livelihoods, they totally rely on the forest. They totally rely on the local biodiversity. So, you know, in terms of farming activities, mm-hmm. fishing, mm-hmm. getting fruits, everything is from the forest. So they don't take account on the local people, even when they start those big projects, environmental projects. Yeah, it's among big international NGOs and state agencies, local people, their interests are not taken into account. That's the very, very big issue. And what I would like to stress, I would like to end by that. Mm-hmm. We can't fight the consequences of the climate crisis. We can't without the involvement of local people. It's not possible. We can't protect the forest without taking into account the interest of people living in that forest.
And that is the voice of Mr. Samuel Yagase, and he's on the front lines. His village is in the Congo Basin, and he is doing his best to round up the folks in the communities and the villages to be able to start standing up to what's happening. So it's my understanding then that Kinshasa is just, and that's the capital of the DRC, is just basically just not doing anything. They're just letting it happen. What type of pressure has been put onto these government officials, the president, to get them to reverse course on this, or at least put some type of check and balance into place? Go ahead, Mr. Maurice Carney.
Sure, and Samuel can speak as well. The essence of the resistance, as Samuel states, is the coming together of the affected communities, local population. An example of this is the Congolese government has recently, just last week, met with the U.S. Climate envoy, former Secretary of State John Kerry, and to discuss the selling or the auctioning of the oil blocks in the Congo. And the minister, one of the ministers, key ministers, Eve Bazaiba, had made the distinction between oxygen and food. And she was saying that's what's at stake, and that the Congolese people have chosen oxygen. That is, I'm sorry, have chosen food. That is to say, they believe that in selling off those oil blocks that are in question, that the Congolese people would benefit and be able to have material benefits or advantages from doing that sale. Now, at the same time, while the government was engaged in a pre-COP meeting with Egypt, folks from Brazil, Indonesia, the major basins throughout the globe, it was a pre-COP meeting in Kinshasa, and John Kerry was there in Kinshasa as well. At the same time, a coalition of NGOs published a study, a report, and it said, it's entitled "Nous garderons nos forêts, vous garderez vos dollars." So they're saying that we keep our forests and you keep your money. So on the one hand, you have the government saying that we choose food over oxygen, and the people saying that we choose the land and the forest over the dollars. And in this report, the local population said they weren't consulted about the oil blocks. They didn't have, by the government or anyone, the implications of drilling in the rainforest could be disastrous for them, as Samuel articulated, as it relates to farming, as it relates to shelter, as it relates to the land, as it relates to fishing. Just the whole existence of large communities would be severely affected, and people would be displaced. So this report is one way in which the local population getting their voice out there, and shows like yours, Sabrina, that provides a platform for local people to speak directly to the global community are so vital. So the struggle is not just organizing on the ground in the Congo, but it's also organizing globally. And a key step in that global organization is information coming directly from the people who are affected, so that we on the global scale, in the global arena, can mobilize and come to their side. Because you have the government and the corporations in this instance against the people. So we want to mobilize people throughout the globe in order to rally behind the frontline defenders in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, specifically in the Congo Basin.
No doubt. And Mr. Samuel Yagase, talk to us about some of the successes, some of the good stuff that has come from your efforts, pulling the villagers together, pulling the communities together to stand up against Kinshasa, your own government, as well as these multinational corporations. Go ahead.
Yeah, I do agree with what Maurice has said. I think I really would like to insist on one fact. Before the breakup of Kinshasa, we had another breakup in Yangambi, I think, a few weeks ago, to prepare the COP 27 in Egypt. But, you know, the meeting was held in Yangambi, and the Yangambi is really in the middle of the Congo Basin rainforest. Unfortunately, local people were not invited. Local NGO were not invited. Even local journalists of community radios were not invited. So I think we can't, we really, I really insist on the fact we can't get sustainable impact about the climate crisis without the local people. It's not possible. And everyone has to understand it. If we look at the behavior of our government, at the same time, they ask people to protect the forest on one hand. On the other hand, they get money from big companies, you know, coming in to cut timber, which is a little bit contradictory. So people are running behind their own interests, and they are neglecting local people, and they are even, you know, they are even sacrificing them, you know, for money, because big companies are coming in with lots of money. So some government officials, you know, they are looking for their own, you know, selfish interests, and they are sacrificing the local people, which is very, very, very sad. Yeah. Even if we look at the COP27 in Egypt, yeah, it's the world meeting. Who is going to attend? From I scientists there. I agree that we need to have you know, people who are deciding, you know, from the different government of the world. Of course, it's true. Mm-hmm. I agree that we need to have academics there in Egypt, but I also agree that we need to get local people delegation, because they understand the problem they are facing in terms of, you know, protecting the forest or being displaced because big companies are coming in. Unfortunately, as I said in the beginning, the local agenda, the local interest, the local community's interests are not taking into account, which is very, very sad.
Right, but Mr.
Sabrina, a few quick points, if I may. Samuel may be a little modest. His village is near the place that he just mentioned, Yangambi. Mm-hmm. And Yangambi is a very significant name and place, because that's where the Belgians during the colonial period had developed a scientific center in the middle of the rainforest. Wow. That was the leading scientific center in Africa as a whole. Mm-hmm. And there's an attempt to resuscitate that center. It serves as a listening outpost and monitoring area for the rainforest, and is filled with Congolese scientists who are studying the rainforest. So Yangambi is very significant as it relates to the Congo Basin. But in Samuel's modesty, his community, a number of years ago, you asked him about successes. They organized and mobilized to drive out a timber company that was trying to set up plantations in the Isangi district, an American timber company. I think the name of it was Blattner Group. They may be out of Pennsylvania or so. So that's one of the local successes, or big local successes, that they've had in shutting down timber operation right there in the Isangi district, right in the heart of the Congo Basin rainforest.
That is amazing. And this is an amazing conversation. Again, folks, we're talking about the Congo Basin, and the climate crisis. And my guests today are Mr. Maurice Carney. He's the executive director of Friends of the Congo, longtime friend of A Rude Awakening, and his colleague on the front lines in the Congo Basin, Mr. Samuel Yagase. Very fact-filled conversation that we're having. Now, let's talk more about, let's get a little bit more technical. I mean, we're talking from the video that we listen to, 4% of the Congo rainforest is storing the equivalent of 20 years of the United States carbon emissions from burning fossil fuels. This is important. It's very scary that people cannot look to the future. And with all of these different, calamities that are happening all over the world, these sudden floods, these sudden fires, you know, it's just, it just seems like they're not listening. Maurice, can you talk about the efforts that Friends of the Congo are putting forth? And then Samuel, you can talk more about what you're experiencing on the front lines. Go ahead, Maurice.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Sabrina. As some of the members of your listening audience may know, each October, Friends of the Congo organizes Congo Week. This is the 15th year of organizing Congo Week. It's a global teaching on the Congo, where we delve into a wide range of issues, and we provide a platform to elevate Congolese voices about the agency that they're taking in tackling many of the challenges that the Congo faces. And one of the areas of focus this year during Congo Week, or as a part of Congo Week, is a special forum that we'll be having on Saturday, October the 29th, it's entitled Congo and the Climate Crisis, Frontline Voices from the Rainforest. So Samuel will be on the panel as well. It will be moderated by Ms. Emira Woods. She's the executive director of the Green Leadership Trust. You have another indigenous representative, Dorothy Lisenga. Dorothy Lisenga, she advocates for women's and lands rights. And she's the winner of the 2018 WEDGO Gender Justice Climate Solutions Award. And Sam, so we'll be having, and for people who want to get more information about this event on the climate crisis, they can go to Congo Week, congoweek.org, and their events calendar. They'll be able to pull it up. And it's also available on Eventbrite. We'll also have two Congolese professors who have written extensive books on one dealing with the legal component of the environmental laws, the global environmental laws. And the second is a professor, one of their professor, he's from, Professor Bindu is his name. He's from the university in Goma in the Congo. And a second professor from the Catholic University in the United States, who has also written a book, he's Congolese, on innovative ways of confronting the climate crisis. So we'll be having book discussions from indigenous leaders, as I stated, on October the 29th. But for people to find out more and tap into these discussions and hear from the Congolese voices, they can visit the website congoweek.org and plug in and register to participate in the upcoming events during Congo Week.
Wonderful, wonderful. Breaking the silence. Sign up for Congo Week, October 16th through the 22nd. October 16th through the 22nd. So that's coming up real, real quick here, folks. I want to have Mr. Samuel Yagase give us the last words of wisdom. Mr. Yagase, go ahead. You have the floor. Talk to us and tell us, reiterate everything that you've been saying about what is going on and what needs to happen and what needs to stop. Talk to us about the Congo Basin once again, protecting it.
Okay, thank you. I think we have this the power will, you know, to support the local communities, and we have to start very soon and campaign to raise your voice. We can't, as you said, we need to break silence and let everyone know from local, the local level, national or international level, that the local community are very, very crucial to protect or to country. They have a key role to play in terms of climate crisis. So we need to pay attention to local people, which is very, very, very important, because they are the ones who are living there, who are facing problems and so on. So we do respect all the partners like international NGOs, state agency, and so on. But local people have to play a critical role. It's very, very important, and we need to, with the help of Friends of the Congo, to start a campaign. We can't cross our hands. We need really to, you know, to promote our community leadership, some kind of leadership from the masses, from the grassroots, in terms of protecting the planet regarding the climate crisis.
I want to thank both of you. Thank you so much. Again, folks, breaking the silence. Congo Week. You can go to congoweek.org and take a look at the calendar of events. It starts October 16th through to the 22nd. Further education on what is happening in the Congo Basin, what is happening with these multinational corporations grabbing land, and the complicity of their government in allowing all of this to happen. It's an intense education. It really, truly is. And hey, you know, we'll make the world better for it. So take that initiative, check it out, congoweek.org. Gentlemen, thank you so much for doing this. And Samuel, I know you're all the way halfway across the world, and appreciate you being able to connect with us so that we can have this very important discussion. Thank you both for being on A Rude Awakening, Mr. Maurice Carney, Mr. Samuel Yagase. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sabrina. Really appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you so much. You are welcome.
And we're going to switch gears just a little bit, folks. Guess what? COP27 will be held in Egypt this year. And of course, A Rude Awakening will be featuring conversations before, during, and after the conference. So to start off the conversations regarding COP27, here's Sophia Murphy, Executive Director of the Institute for Agriculture and Trade Policy, discussing her expectation for COP27. Figures.
Well, it's all of that sort of folded into political work, though. Like, how can we get the best out of the institutions and regulations that are taking us forward, that we decide collectively in a political process? So it's trying to put that science and knowledge together with what movements are talking about, what people and communities are organizing. But we are very much a policy think tank, in the sense that we focus on what we can change. Is there a law that needs to change? Is there public money that needs to be invested? Is there some kind of behavior that needs to be stopped? And the COP, the conference, the party sort of brings a lot of those things together, because it's where we're going to get action on something that's actually a global problem. And it's where the countries make commitments to each other. And of course, you know, it's not like every country is equal, but it is a place where even a behemoth like the United States has to take account of itself and its place and how it's affecting other countries. So it feels like a very important place for us who work at the state level, and then at the national level. We're also watching what happens globally and how we're dealing with this problem together. And those discussions happen at the COP.
Right. And that's the thing. It's like, okay, many people are of the opinion that it's time for action. It is time for action. And that the Conference of Parties is just, you know, it's just that, a conference, you know, more talk. You know, do you really feel like anything can be gained? Can you reflect back on any policies that the IETP has been, you know, promoting, pushing, creating, that have, you know, become reality for folks that are on the front lines, that are dealing with, you know, all of these different, you know, catastrophic events, these climate events that are happening?
I mean, I think we're living climate change. You know, it's no longer something that might happen in the future that we argue about. It is happening. We've seen it across North America, and many countries are seeing it as well. COP27. That means it's been 27 years since the conference of the parties have been meeting. And I actually started my career at the UN Earth Summit, where this was signed, the Framework Convention on Climate Change, in 1992. So yeah, there's frustration. There's some sense of when will this all add up to something more than just discussion? But, you know, if we hadn't had that intergovernmental conference, there would be no framework convention on climate change, and there wouldn't be the commitments that we have, weak as they are. So I think for ITP, there's just this, you know, deep belief and commitment to a system where we have a space to come and talk and to coordinate action where we can. It can't only happen there. And for most people in most countries, the things that you see that make a difference, you know, it's your municipality making a decision, your state, perhaps, your maybe a group of countries together that are able to stop some behavior or invest in some piece of infrastructure that will protect them as the climate changes. And those are real tangible things. They don't happen at the COP. What the conference, the parties can do is to stop things we don't want to see happen. This year, there's a lot of talk about things like carbon farming, different ways in which you would, in our opinion, kind of kick the ball down the road and not actually get on with cutting emissions. So we're there to make sure that those loopholes don't get codified and accepted. And then we're there to fight for the money that's needed. A country like the United States is as rich as it is because of all of the resource exploitation it's gone in for, all of the climate changing gas that it has emitted. And so we have a responsibility to other countries, both to help them pay for technologies to sidestep the mistakes we've made and to make up for many of them, to invest in their adaptations, because they're going to have to build higher seawalls. They're going to have to rebuild houses and buildings. They're going to have to do all kinds of investment to better climate proof where they live. You know, on the coming on the heels of Hurricane Ian, we're not unfamiliar with that right here in the United States. And you can just imagine what that's like for much smaller, poorer countries to have to find that money. So that's a big, important discussion in Egypt coming up. It's also a place to hold people accountable. People often will make big announcements there. We're there to say, okay, so is this announcement going to help us or not? If it's a good one, can we cheer you on? Where can we get momentum behind it? Last year, there was a methane pledge. That was an important initiative. The US, about 100 other countries signed in to cut the methane emissions that they're responsible for. These are all things that happen on the sidelines of a conference that you can also get momentum for, because everyone is gathered. There's a lot of public attention. Heads of state want something to say.
Yeah. When there's a fight, it's especially when it's such a huge one, the big one like this, it's like, okay, well, you got the negotiators, you know, you've got the folks that are able to have those conversations, have those contentious conversations, right? Mm-hmm. And able to, you know, those bridge creators, you know, between, you know, the front lines, between, you know, the folks that are suffering and the folks who are privileged enough not to be in those situations, who are, you know, immigrés as opposed to migrants, you know, or climate refugees, or, you know what I'm saying? So it's mm-hmm. like, okay, there's these different, all these different labels and whatnot. So it's, when I have conversations like this with you, Ms. Sophia Murphy, Executive Director of IATP, it's hopeful. I feel personally, on a personal level, I feel very, very hopeful. I feel very, very good. I'm like, okay, you know, there's people that are, you know, that understand that feel the hurt of the folks that are on the front lines, that are going to be pushing for negotiations to help those people. But at the same time, it's like, you know, I'll have a conversation with someone who is on the front line and they're like, we don't have any time. What do we have? You know, and they're going to show up. They're going to be at COP, you know, they're at COP, they're all at the COPs outside protesting, you know, letting their voices be heard. You know, and it's to the point where it's like, it's not even about a voice being heard. It's about things being done. I mean, people are dying because of this climate crisis right now, today, this moment. You know what I mean? So what say you to that?
Well, I think we just have maybe we don't have an existential threat like climate change quite like it anywhere else, but it's true for the people who have no shelter. It's true for the 850 million people in the world who don't have enough to eat every day. It's there are many, many traumas, many, many social failings that we live with and try to do something about. And I think it is important to remain hopeful. And I think it is important to know that it's lots of little actions that add up. It's not like one big place to either give in to despair or to make the one change that would make everything better for all time. I think it just is. One of the things the conference does, and it's not the only place it would happen. In fact, Egypt, our chance for that outside kind of energizing protest is going to be very limited. It's not a government that allows civil discourse to be expressed in public open spaces. You cannot say what you think. So there's going to be that further restriction on what we're doing. And yet we need these places where we come together. We need places where other countries can come and say, you know, cutting off that civil society discourse is not the way forward. And we need to, you know, share strategies and stories. And it's not for everyone. And I certainly don't think everyone should be buying a ticket to Egypt. But I think some of us need to go bear witness and report on what's happening there. And share the stories we have that give us hope, but also hold our governments to account. It's a crucial part of an intergovernmental system that they, non-government, you know, civil society plays the role of accountability, of witness. And I just think that it's not for everybody. It's not even maybe for most people, but it is really important. And I hope it can bring hope to people in the front line. But I absolutely understand why they would say, hey, have a nice time out there halfway across the world. But meanwhile, I've got, you know, stone barriers to build and, you know, hurricane proof roofs to put on houses here. And of course that also has to happen. And I really would say to Sabrina, like it's our governments who are there. So in as much as we are part of a democracy and, you know, hold our governments to account, it's not just the bourgeoisie in the sense of like, of course, the people who go there are not facing hunger every day. They're not facing the threat of their island going under, although some of them come from countries that are threatened, whose existence. But just to say it is the public space and it is things done in our name. So I do think that it's important that we are able to go there and say, as we have to say quite often, not in our name or this in our name. You know, there is a politics to it, as well as the need for the money and the decisions to come.
And thank you for emphasizing that, you know, that it's not only just the bourgeoisie, but it's also the governments that are conversing with the bourgeoisie.
Yes, absolutely. That they don't hear from enough diversity of voices, and holding a conference in Sharm el-Sheikh, you know, it's like a walled resort town in a country, as they say, that hasn't gone in for freedom of expression for a long time. You know, it's not an ideal place for them to be hearing from people. So I don't want to make light of that either, but I do feel so strongly that when our governments are meeting and you know, it's our money that pays for them to go, it's our tax money that's there, it's our elected representatives, then we need to be making sure that what they do is something we can, that we accept.
That's right. Hold them to account. You know, we put them there, so they better do what they're supposed to do. You know, we got to hold their feet to the fire. Absolutely. I agree. Yeah, it's a tricky situation. And I of course feel all sides of it. And just I keep reiterating that because it's important. I understand where front lines of communities are coming from. I understand where organizations like yours are play a very pivotal role, Sophia Murphy. And I understand where these politicians are coming from, because in a lot of these situations, they're having their hands tied, you know, they're having their hands tied by the money. You know, the money is tying them up instead of them untying the money so that it flows properly. You know, they're bound by these ridiculous,
no shortage of vested interests who, you know, will be at COP or just not even going, but able to try and thwart the actions that we need, unfortunately. But luckily, there are some also voices organized on the other side.
Most definitely. Well, and your organization, Institute for Agriculture and Trade Policy, is, you know, that your organization is based, and I want folks to know that if you don't already know that, IATP is about getting the facts out those numbers, data-driven, research-driven information to the public. So it's not just this, you know, conjecture or, you know, opinion pieces that are coming out of this organization. They're letting everyone know exactly what's going on with the numbers. They're backing everything's backed up or fronted with research, data-driven research. So just want to reiterate that. And Sophia Murphy, thank you so much. You are the executive director of that amazing organization, IATP, doing the amazing work. Close us out. Give us some last words here. It's so wonderful to speak with you. So give us
Thanks so much, Sabrina. And thank you for that warm plug. We do try and do that synthetic research of pulling things together, having the numbers, the facts, so also the experiences. You know, it's for us, it's also about the knowledge that comes from people who farm, people who live in these crises that we're talking about and trying to turn around in order to have fairer, more sustainable food systems. And I guess I would just say, I think hope is really crucial to doing anything, just to getting up in the morning and taking on the challenges that we have. And so many people are doing that together. So these moments like COP are a chance to be reminded that we're not the only ones who are worried. And we're not the only ones who care. And so looking around for that inspiration, I think that there'll be sights to be seen there, and no doubt sights to be seen all around, because COP is also a moment that people choose for organizing events and demonstrations and the like at home. So look around and see. But I think there'll be a busy conversation happening, not just in Egypt, but all across the planet come that first 2 weeks of November.
Most definitely. That is so true. And that's what it's about. It is still about that conversation, so that we can start mitigating these issues, you know. Scary times we are living in. I tell you, scary times. Sophia Murphy, Executive Director of IATP. Folks, you can go to IATP.org, IATP.org. And just peruse their website. Check out some stories. The work that they do is beyond important, because it can be added to work that's already been done and make this beautiful presentation as far as this is the story that we're looking at as far as the climate crisis is concerned. This is how it can be applied to whatever portion of the movement that you are engaging in, and add the necessary substance, the necessary data-driven substance that's always needed in the arguments. Sophia Murphy, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening. Truly appreciate you taking the time. Thank you.
It was my pleasure. Thank you so much, Sabrina.
And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A big thank you to my guests, Maurice Carney, Samuel Yagase, and Sophia Murphy, for taking the time. And a huge virtual hug of gratitude to you, dear listener, for all your generosity during our last fun drive.
Herbie Hancock.
So I decided to use this kind of analytical mind that I have. And I said, okay, wait a minute, let me think about this. I said, is there anything wrong with watermelons? Nope. Is there anything wrong with the watermelon man? Nope. That was my answer. There was nothing wrong. And so it was right then that I decided I have to stand up for what I believe in and what is right and what I feel, follow my heart. There were even some musicians that, you know, when I told them I wrote this song called Watermelon Man, they said, you're not going to call it Watermelon Man, are you? No, really, it was like that back then.
KPFA, storytelling for social change.
I hate the capitalist system.
Please join KPFA at the Freight and Salvage on Monday, October 17th at 7 p.m., when we welcome the legendary Barbara Dane in celebration of the release of Barbara's autobiography, This Bell Still Rings, My Life of Defiance and Song. This live in-person event will be hosted by KPFA's own Chris Welch, and will include special guests such as Tammy Hall, Holly Neer, Maureen Gosling, Avacha, Mark Hummel, and Pablo Mendez. That's Monday, October 17th at 7 p.m. For tickets, log on to kpfa.org/events.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.com.